is loving. We affirm, I am a loving, caring presence. Just as the sun shines on everyone and everything, we are a loving presence to everyone we meet. Our kind words, welcoming smile, and compassionate actions all spring from the love that is part of our divine identity. Being a loving presence draws us closer to God and to all people. We want to share the love we have known throughout the seasons of our life, at heights of triumphs and joy, and the depths of loss and suffering. God is love, and so are we. No matter who we meet or what they're going through, we are loving. We bring support, kindness, solace, and comfort, and share them lavishly without thought of reciprocity. We are the hands and heart of God in the world. And from Romans we hear, owe no one anything except to love one another, for the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. And together we repeat the affirmation, I am a loving, caring presence. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Lainey. And now, Pete.
Good morning, everyone. The unity concept for this Sunday is divine order. Thank you, Tasha. And again, with your mics muted, let's say the affirmation together. By the power of order, I am capable of orderly thought and action. I easily adjust thought and action in response to shifting circumstances. I am ever evolving spiritually. When we have been planning and our plans turn out well, we may be tempted to think it must be in divine order. When we don't understand why something unwanted has happened, we may be tempted to think it must be in divine order. Divine order, however, is never a preordained or imposed condition. Divine order is a principle and a power of our spiritual capacity of orderly action, mental adjustment, and spiritual evolution. We name it divine because God is the organizing principle found in it, the structure, pattern, and sequence inherent in all that is, all that exists and is created. We are fully human and fully divine. The more we attune to our divine identity, realizing oneness with God, the more readily we increase our innate capacity for spiritual or divine order. In the revealing word, Unity co-founder Charles Fillmore defines order this way, quote, the divine idea of order is the idea of adjustment, and as this is established in human thought, our mind and affairs will be one with the spiritual harmony, unquote. We find empowerment and freedom in our ability to adjust, shift, flip a switch, transform, or modify our thought and action. Think of a time when your flight got canceled at the last minute. Recall the varying reactions among travelers, those who loudly protested and those who quietly altered their plans. Think about another time when your plans were interrupted or changed. Remember when you successfully adjusted your thought and action in such a way that you established order in the midst of changing conditions. You demonstrated the adjusting power of order. By acknowledging God, the organizing principle, and exercising our rightful power of divine order, we evolve. We can look back today and notice our progress through time. As with any consistent practice, our effort to cultivate order increases our access to the principle and our ability to embody the organizing, adjusting, and evolving power of order. And the affirmation again is, by the power of order, I am capable of orderly thought and action. I easily adjust thought and action in response to shifting circumstances. I am ever evolving spiritually. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Pete. And as I said, this is about embracing change. So our Daily Word song is actually two songs with a slideshow. This is something that I presented at our 30th anniversary. So this may bring back a few memories for people.
Mm-hmm. place where you can always go. Come with me. Where it's all right to let your feelings show. Come with me. What a pleasant journey. Isn't very far. We can go together. Stay right where you are. And now it's time to start. It's right here in your heart. There is a place where you can be yourself. Come with me. It's a place where you can free yourself. Come with me. And you know it's waiting, not so far away. Need no reservations, we could go today. Now it's time to start. It's right here in your. And the door is open wide, and each question has an answer if you'll only look inside. There is a place where every sorrow ends. Come with me. Where hope and every truth begins. Come with me. What a pleasant journey. Isn't very far. We can go together. Stay right where you are. Now it's time to start. It's right here in your. And now it's time to start. It's right here in your heart.
Oh, so many memories there. And there were many more people who weren't even in that video that have touched our lives. We're going to, again, continue to change things up a little by doing the meditation first and then the talk next. So I'm going to ask you to get completely comfortable, close your eyes, put your feet flat on the floor, roll your head around so that you are loose and relaxed. Sit back, feel the chair beneath you completely support you. Breathe deeply and fully. Breathe in through your nose to the count of four. Breathe out through your mouth to the count of five. As you breathe, give yourself a little Mona Lisa smile, or Buddha smile if you prefer. Breathe in thoughts of love, peace, and positivity. Breathe out any thoughts of fear and negativity. Feel yourself go completely limp. I'm going to take you on a journey. You are walking along a path. The pathway is not completely straight and level. It goes up and down, this way and that, constantly changing. Parts of it are easy. Parts of it are hard. Along this pathway, you see scenes of people and places from long ago. You realize that you are seeing the story of your life. Some of the scenes you see bring back feelings of nostalgia. Some of the scenes may be difficult to watch. As you walk, you notice that you can't see very far in front of you. And if you look behind, the images become somewhat distorted. You also notice that when you look ahead, it may cause a bit of anxiety because you're not sure where this path is going. When you look behind you, it leaves you longing for what was. But you keep walking, and little by little, as you walk along, you start to lose yourself in this moment and appreciate where you are, here and now. As your appreciation for this moment, here and now, grows, you feel gratitude for all that is. All that has brought you to this place and time that makes you the wonderful being that you are. And you say to yourself, I am so grateful for this place and time. I am so grateful for this place and time. Say it with me to yourself. I am so grateful for this place and time. Let us take a few moments to reflect on the changes that have brought us to this place and time. And now we bring to mind anyone who's in need of prayer. Thank you, Divine Spirit, for this journey that is my life, for all the changes that have brought me to this place and time, for all that has been and all that's to come. We bless this journey and ask for your guidance. We rest in the gratitude for the journey that is our life. And as we slowly come back from our journey, back into the room where you are, we do so with a new, renewed appreciation for this moment. We can open our eyes. Welcome back. It's so good to see your faces. And so you may be asking, so why is this talk about embracing change? Well, as we know, we are selling the building. And as a matter of fact, we have a closing date of this Wednesday. So this is entitled Embracing Change, Looking Back, Looking Ahead. So I'm going to start with some quotes about embracing change. Resilience is accepting our new reality, even if it's less good than the one we had before. You can fight it. You can do nothing but scream about what you've lost, or you can accept that and try to put together something that's good. Elizabeth Edwards. I cannot say whether things will get better if we change. What I can say is that they must change if they are to get better. George Christoph Lichtenberg. Change is a four-letter word. I'm sorry, change is not a four-letter word, but often your reaction to it is. Jeffrey Gittimer. And finally, life is like underwear, change is good. Ray Bradbury. From the moment we are born, we are changing. If we are to grow, we must change. Astronomers tell us that the universe as a whole is constantly changing, growing, expanding, which I believe is the reason why my waistline is expanding in recent years. After all, my waistline is part of the universe. But we resist change. We complain about change. Rarely does complaining about change make it stop or make it happen. Change is simply a part of life. As we age, we go through different stages of change, and our ability to accept and even embrace change changes. We start out as stubborn little children who want things a certain way. I have a friend who, when they were young, wouldn't eat their food if different things on their plate were touching, even if it meant she went hungry. As we grow up, we start to look forward to certain changes. I couldn't wait to learn to drive, to graduate high school, and get out into the real world. As a young person, I remember my parents telling me that I had to be in bed by 10 o'clock. I couldn't wait to grow up so I could stay up as late as I want to. Now that I'm older, it turns out that time is 10 o'clock. In our 20s, 30s, 40s, we might have looked forward to things like getting a place of our own, getting a good job, maybe falling in love or starting a family, and growing more self-assured in who we are. But after 50 or 60, we tend to be less open to change once again. We spend a lot of time looking back, talking about the good old days. We use phrases like, those were the days, or they don't make them like they used to, or these kids nowadays. When I was a kid, I had to walk 10 miles to school, through snow, uphill, both ways. I see people of my generation saying it about the current generation. I know my parents said it about my generation, and I bet their parents said it about them. Personally, I can remember having to walk through 10 feet of shag carpet to change the channel on the TV. Here are some examples of my generation making fun of the millennium generation. Tosh, I apologize. So we're going to see a little bit of a comedian named Brad Upton.
Call it a safe space.
Here we go.
One simple but brilliant trick to cool your home in 90
sorry
seconds.
About the commercial.
Tired of hot and...
There. Age of 30, 20-somethings? Let me hear from the 20-somethings.
Yeah, yeah.
These are the dumbest people I've ever met in my life. Not personally, just as a group. Do me a favor, put some cash in your pocket, squeeze your debit cards every $1.17 purchase. I get so tired of standing mine on a mini mart. That's $1.17. Here's my debit card. You don't have a buck and a quarter? I know they're dumber than people my age. You know, when I was growing up, we didn't have any childproof caps. You dropped a Coke bottle, it didn't bounce, it shattered. Our parents let us play with guns and knives and fireworks. You know what happened to the dumb kids? They didn't make it. It's true. These guys grew up in a world that's childproofed and padded. All the dumb ones lived. Now they use debit cards, $1.17 purchases. You ever see what they're buying? Energy drinks. How much energy do you need in your 20s? Should be selling those at the retirement village. That's the target market right there. A couple of monsters and a Red Bull gonna pick up that bingo game, I'm sure. B19, that's mine. A lot of our terms don't mean anything. I don't want to sound like a broken record. You know what that means, right? People under 30 never owned a record player. They don't know what that means. They don't know what that means. They don't know what that means. You still don't.
This is Dew, our latest water-friendly all-terrain sneaker.
Okay, I'll stop there. But who here remembers rotary dial telephones that hung on a wall? Remember the good thing about those? Yeah. You got mad at somebody during a conversation? Bing! Man, if you hit that thing hard enough, you could really make that bell ring. Try to do that with a cell phone. Not the same. How about transistor radios? Black and white TVs with rabbit ears? Drive-in movies? Saturday morning cartoons, bell bottoms. Yeah, it's only fun to reminisce. It's only human to look back through rose-colored glasses at past experience. But the truth is, there really were no good old days in a sense. The good old days always were, always are, right here, right now. Here's a quote from old-time theater critic Brooks Atkinson. He said, in every age, the good old days were a myth. No one ever thought they were good at the time. Every age has consisted of crises that seemed intolerable at the time to the people who lived through them. I'm sure years from now, the Gen Zers will look back at these days with nostalgia, remembering their good old days, despite the fact that there was looming climate change, a global pandemic, great political division, mass shootings, the January 6th attack on the Capitol, supply chain problems, and historic inflation. Why would they look back on these days with nostalgia? Because it's easy to get stuck in the past. Even people who are innovators, who are genius in one field, can get stuck in a way of thinking that won't allow them to accept and adapt to change. Example? Henry Ford. Here was a man who was so brilliant, he conceived of a new way to build cars called the assembly line that allowed for the middle class to be able to afford the automobile. Ford's innovation brought the cost of an automobile down from an average of $800 to around 300. Because of it, Ford dominated the car market. Every 10 seconds, a new Model T rolled off the assembly line. 40% of all cars sold in America were Model Ts. But then Henry Ford got stuck in his way of thinking. When other car companies started offering cars in other colors, people asked him, when was he going to offer cars in different colors? And Henry Ford is famously quoted as saying, "You can paint the Model T any color you want, as long as it's black." Other car companies started offering cars that were larger, more luxurious, had more horsepower, and of course, other colors. The Ford Motor Car Company fell behind in the market, and it took them years to catch up again. So how do we navigate change? To paraphrase Eric Butterworth, change your thinking, change your life. If the event is positive, then embracing it is easy. Should change be a significant and unexpected life event, death of a loved one, being released from a job, a health challenge, then finding peace with the change may take some time. So how do we embrace the change rather than being fearful of the unknown? Here are some suggestions from Unity author Elaine Mayer. Number one, have faith. Rest in your faith and remain there, centered in the presence of God. Number two, look toward tomorrow. The sun will come out tomorrow. Know and affirm with conviction that better days are ahead. If worry and sorrow persist, acknowledge that this is the human side of your journey, and that's okay. Get help if need be. Number three, remember, you are not alone. If feelings of restlessness steal your peace of mind, turn within for comfort and reassurance by connecting with the one presence and power. And from Unity Minister Carla McClellan, be willing to say yes to what is. Even if those situations are causing you discomfort, when you say yes, you are accepting the facts of the situation, but not its power over you. Acceptance offers us up to a field of possibilities, and we see that there are many choices before us. Now, another helpful thing I have found is to look to people who have gone through tough times and found a way to adapt and even embrace change. An example, there was a man who was out of work. He was called back for a second job interview. He had seen his share of tough times. He had already declared bankruptcy not once, but twice. He really thought that this job was going to be his big break. But once there, he learned that they had decided to go with someone else. On his way home, on the train, he drew his first Mickey Mouse. Imagine what a loss it would have been if Walt Disney had gotten that job. Then there's our own Wizard of Joy, Gail Ann Bruin. Hi, Gail Ann. Gail Ann went through some tough times. In 2010, she lost her husband of 38 years. She couldn't afford to maintain their home on her own, and it took a couple of years to clean it out. With only 2 weeks before the sale went through, she had no place to move to. With no family to turn to, she was about to be homeless. She would affirm a saying she learned from artist and author Florence Scovel Shinn. That saying is, "God makes a way where there is no way." I'll repeat that. God makes a way where there is no way. That's when she found an apartment in this town somewhere out in Warren County called Washington. She knew nothing about Warren County, but she adapted, driving as far as Piscataway for her newfound passion, Latin line dancing. Right, Gail Ann? Mm-hmm. Then in 2020, the pandemic hit, and after several months of virtual isolation, she found herself alone, wailing from the loneliness. And she thought to herself, if I, a therapist with over 40 years of experience, am having this much trouble, how are other people coping? And that's when she came up with the idea of Jolts of Joy, a Zoom class she does Saturday mornings that has given many the tools for stopping the joy thief and putting joy back into your life. And it is a wonderful class. Now, on a personal level, our own daughter, Sarah, she went through a period where, already dealing with anxiety, she found out her live-in boyfriend was cheating on her. The gym she was managing, she found herself looking for a new place to live, not once, but twice, and she broke her leg. This all happened within 9 months. Well, she got professional help for the anxiety, dumped her boyfriend, started her own fitness company with two friends, which is doing so well that she has no bookings left for any of her Zoom classes. Oh yes, that was a side benefit of COVID. She found that she could teach people, train people via Zoom. And now she has people that she trains remotely all over the country, including her own dad. Our world, our has gone through some challenging times as of late. The pandemic affected and is still affecting the entire world. Over 6.3 million people worldwide have died so far because of COVID, and an estimated 3.4 billion, yes, that's billion with a B, people have had at least one case of COVID. That's almost 44% of the world's population. Businesses have been forced to close. People were laid off. Scientists adapted and developed vaccines and medicines. Our government adapted with stimulus checks and grants and PPP. Our own minister, Carmela, adapted with a little help from her daughter-in-law, getting that PPP to keep us going financially. She also learned, as we all did, how to use Zoom so that we could keep meeting. So now we face a new challenge. Our building is about to be sold, where so many memories have been made. And we are becoming a hybrid center. Live for those who prefer seeing each other in person, and streaming for those who prefer to watch at home in their PJs. We can look back and mourn the fact that we no longer have our own building and we used to have more people. Or we can be grateful for the fact that we had those great times with those people and we're still going. We may be small, but we are a tight-knit group. Some of us are knit tighter than others. Just kidding. For all the teachings that have helped me become who I am today and adapt to life's changes, I am so grateful. For all the friends that we've had at Unity. Personally, although I leave lots of memories behind at that building, I know that Unity Spiritual Center is so much more than a building. We could meet anywhere and we'd still be us, sharing smiles, making new memories, continuing our spiritual journey. Moving our center may seem scary, but when you move to a new house, it's the same thing. I look forward to our new home because it will give us the opportunity to put our energies into helping our community and furthering our spiritual growth without the financial requirements we could no longer afford. Personally, I can't wait to see you all in person again and give each of you a big hug. Lastly, life keeps changing. Not all the changes may seem good at the time, but we must adapt to the changes or face living in the past or being afraid of the future. Let us all remember every day that we are given. These are the good old days, and I am so glad and humbled to share them with you. Thank you so much. And now, Franny.
What's next? Are we going to do a song or are we going to do the offering first?
Blessing of the gifts.
Okay.
Offering.
Okay. now is our opportunity to give. And so we ask that you, well, first, let me say thank you for the generosity of this community, always, for all the giving of the time, the talent, and the treasures. That is what makes our Unity Center, not the building, but the people in it, and our willingness to give so generously of ourselves in all ways that make us a true loving community. And I say thank you for that. And we ask that you hold your gift in your hand, either genuinely or metaphorically, and together we will say the blessing of our gifts. Next slide, Tosh. With me, with your mics muted, divine love, as me, blesses and multiplies all that I choose to give and all that I am open to receive, and I am grateful.
And next we have the closing song. And before Pete cues it up, I want to just say a little bit about the song. As I mentioned, I gain inspiration from those who have faced the greatest changes and challenges with grace and bravery and gratitude. Here is a song about a man who faced the greatest of all changes and challenges by living every day to the fullest. Pete?
Yep.
I met Ron on a Zoom call in 2020. He told me that after a three...
What a beautiful example of embracing change. And I want to thank everyone who joined us via the live stream. If you're interested in attending via Zoom, please contact through Facebook Messenger or email at unity, I'm sorry, email unity at unityspiritualcenter.org. Thank you so much. And now it's time for our announcements. And I also want to add something to our announcements. We didn't have time to get this on the announcements, but we are going to meet tomorrow, Monday afternoon at 12, to transport items to our storage facility. And we need volunteers. So if you can be there tomorrow at 12, we would really appreciate helping us move some boxes and other things. Yes, and the pumpkins.
It's the final push, guys. It's the final move.
Yep. If you would do the other announcements here.
Okay. So this is our financial status as of the 21st of July. Our operating